Well, I want to thank you for being here. It's amazing and gratifying to see a full house. It's so fun. The chamber is 75 years old, and you might be wondering why I'm here. Who am I? I'm Lynn Snodgrass. I'm the CEO of the Gresham Area Chamber of Commerce. And this year, the chamber is 75 years old. And to be perfectly honest, I don't have any idea if we've ever got to host this event before in the 75 years or recently. So we're really honored whether we got to before or not. I'm darn glad we got to this year. So thank you for giving us that opportunity. I want to thank the MetroEast Community Media for recording this. And I also want to say a special thank you to the Gresham Rotarians. They meet every Wednesday at M&M, and today they're here with us. So I want to thank you very much for making that accommodation, Rotarians. Well, I did the math. I knew I was going to introduce the mayor today, so I thought I'd go to my best subject in school, and that's math. That's also a lie. I did the math. Mayor Bemis was elected in 2007, the youngest mayor of Gresham at the age of 34. So 34 in 2007 makes him 43 in 2016. 2016 minus 43 is 1973. So he was born in 1973. So I went on that Google thing and looked up what happened in 1973 because I was just a mere kid at the time. I was actually very in love with my husband. But so I went back and looked to see what was happening, and there were some really amazing things happening in 1973. Stamps were 8 cents. The ceasefire was signed, ending the Vietnam involvement. Nixon, on TV, accepted responsibility, not blame, for Watergate. Miami won the Super Bowl. Billie Jean King won Wimbledon. Secretariat won the Kentucky Derby and went on to do the Triple Crown. Marlon Brando won Best Actor for The Godfather. And the Nobel Peace Prize winner was Henry Kissinger. Well, I knew that wasn't enough to grab your attention, and I knew that a lot of you won't know all the history about mayor, so I dug a little deeper to find some more details. So I went back into that Google thing and Googled a little more, and I stumbled onto a very interesting fact. He was born in 1972. So I started all over again. Nothing happened in 1972. Nothing. I was so enthralled with everything that happened in 1973. Nothing happened in 1972, except Shane was born. Corey, thank you for that. It made it a memorable year. Henry, that was the mom clapping. No, I'm kidding. Henry Kissinger said, 90% of politicians give the other 10% a bad reputation. Mayor Bemis is one of those 10%. He works hard, is determined to do what's right. He's flexible, all while keeping his eye on the future of our community. And he is selfless in the process. Harry Truman wisely said years ago, "It's amazing what you can accomplish when you don't care who gets the credit." Mayor Bemis is living that now as well. You don't see him calling out a new initiative and naming it the Shane thing. No, he's concerned about what's happening in our schools, on our roads, in our backyards, and he wants to make it better, safer, and more livable. He doesn't care who gets the credit, only that it gets done. Mayor Bemis is a business owner, a father, husband, and a public servant, and in my eyes, he's a statesman. Many of you have heard me use that word before. Statesman is a very important word to me. A politician and a statesman are not the same thing. A statesman is not power hungry. He's a free leader of free people, and he must possess 4 critical qualities: a bedrock of principles, that solid foundation, a moral compass, a vision, and the ability to build consensus to achieve that vision. Over the course of his service to our community, Mayor Bemis has displayed over and over again all four pillars. They're hand in hand in his life. Please welcome to the podium for the 2016 State of the City Address, a statesman in my eyes, Mayor Shane Bemis.
Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction, Lynn, and I know I have my marching orders for the next 4 years, so thank you very much for that. When I think about all the folks in this room, and I think about the human infrastructure in our region, I think about people like Lynn Snodgrass, who work so tremendously hard to be exceptional community stewards wherever they are. I also want to thank Lynn for her leadership of this chamber and all the great work that's been happening under her leadership with all of your help. So thank you, Lynn. I also want to thank the Chamber of Commerce for co-hosting this event with us for the first time. I've been very impressed again with the Chamber's progress, and I remain convinced that a strong Chamber of Commerce is an absolutely critical part of a strong community. And I've probably told you this story enough times over the years that many of you are getting tired of hearing it, but you have to be patient with me because I can't not tell it. I am absolutely convinced that if it were not for the Gresham Chamber of Commerce, my first business in Gresham would have never made it. After leveraging every possible resource I had just to get the open sign lit, I had exactly nothing remaining for advertising and promotions. So I worked the chamber and I worked it hard. I go to Friday AMs and give away some pizzas, I'd hand out some coupons and encourage my fellow chamber members to give us a try. And without fail, the phone would start ringing at lunch, mostly calls from chamber members. And then Friday night, I'd have a steady stream of chamber members ordering pizza, giving me their business, and more importantly, giving me a future. I simply will never forget how important this organization has been to my success and remains to the success of all of our business and our local economy. So thank you. Be it the Chamber of Commerce, City Hall, churches, rotaries, Elks clubs, school PTAs, neighborhoods, or community groups. The social fabric I just described is the capital that pays dividends in every possible way in our city. It pays in the health of an economy, the health of our families, and our sense of livability and belonging. So once again, let me start this annual address by expressing my gratitude for those strong bonds in our community and for everything this city has meant to me since I came here as a freshman in high school with no relationships and no connections. The State of the City is one of my favorite annual events because it gives me the opportunity to share some of the outstanding things we have going on in our community, while also trying to forecast a bit about the challenges that are ahead. Before I get too far down that road with this year's conversation, I do want to take a moment to recognize our strong community leadership, starting with the members of our City Council. As a team, we have made the purposeful effort to operate in the style of a board of directors for a $220 million enterprise, because that's exactly what we are. Council President Palmero, Councilor Eccles, Hinton, French, Stegman, and Widmark are some of the finest individuals I have ever worked with. You know, in an era when local government leadership is too often defined by rancor, discord, political struggles, sometimes pub fights, our team is a shining example of cooperation, disagreement with respect, and hearts that are absolutely focused on the community and our outcomes, as opposed to political football. Please join me in thanking our city councilors for their leadership. And in addition to our city councilors, we're joined today by some special guests and partners from around the region. In no particular order, we have Multnomah County Chair Deborah Cafori with us. We have that's a good applause. We have Multnomah County Commissioner Diane McKeel. Diane. Metro President Tom Hughes. Metro Councilor Shirley Craddock. We have Deborah Durr, President of Mountain Hood Community College, is with us. Deborah. Janet Labar, the President and CEO of Greater Portland, Inc. Thank you, Janet, for being here. One of my absolute favorites, Tracy Rose of Boys and Girls Club, is here. Tracy. My friend and somebody that we have a lot of work to do and with both of our two cities is the mayor of Happy Valley, Lori DeRemer. Thank you, Mayor DeRemer, for being here. We also have Tammy Arnold, Fairview City Councilor. Where are you, Tammy? And our school districts, which I'm so pleased are here, Jim Schlachter from Gresham-Barlow School District, Linda Florence from Reynolds School District, Sam Breyer from Centennial School District. We have Susie Jones, the Mount Hood Community College Chair. Susie's here. Travis Stovall, our representative to the TriMet Board. Travis Stovall's here. We also have Grace Stratton from Senator Wyden's office is with us. And we have some former city councilors who were exceptional in their own right and were an absolute pleasure to work with as well. Councilor Dave Shields, Councilor Paul Warking, Councilor Carol Nielsen Hood, and Councilor Mike McCormick. I also want to recognize my family for being here. They allow me to do this crazy thing that I do, and I couldn't absolutely do it without them. First, the loving support of my wife, Alex. Thank you for all that you do. My mother, Corey. Sometimes she feels like my wife, my dad, my everything. My mother-in-law, Nora, and my father-in-law, Rio, and my kids. Derek was up here singing, Jacob's right there, Luke is there, and good friend and the guy that manages the restaurant so that I can do this, Steve Hall, is here as well. So thank you for all your support. Since this is the Chamber of Commerce, I'll start this year's address by speaking to some of our recent economic progress. Now, no matter how you slice it, in 2015, it was a really solid economic year. Raise your hand if you've ever heard me talk about the Gresham Vista Industrial Park near ON Semiconductor. Okay, well that's right. For years I've been saying how close we are to landing major economic investment on this prime industrial parcel. Our partners at the Port of Portland were absolutely instrumental in wrestling this parcel out of passive ownership in 2011 and working incredibly hard to market the site, join with us in our efforts to bring jobs and investment to this community. There is no question that the Port is an absolute key partner in our efforts on this site. I was incredibly proud this year to say that Subaru's Master Distribution Center marks our first large-scale investment on Vista with their 600,000 square foot facility and $33 million investment. And as you can see on this slide, we still have a lot of land remaining for further industrial investment, and I remain convinced that we will be talking about progress on this site during the State of the City addresses for years to come. I do want to pause for just a moment to recognize, on scale, how big of a deal Subaru is. This was our largest industrial recruitment in over 10 years, and it was the second largest new traded sector construction project in the entire Portland metropolitan region in 2015. Second only, I might add, to Intel's expansion. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah. Now, Subaru was far from our only advancement in the economic development arena. In total, we had 22 industrial expansions, 8 new manufacturing buildings. We issued 291 business licenses, a 27% increase over the previous year, and we welcomed 16 new traded sector companies to Gresham. In 2014, we had 319,000 square feet of new commercial construction. In 2015, over triple that amount with over 1 million square feet. So when it comes to jobs, yeah, that's okay. When it comes to jobs, 2015 was a good year for us. And that was not by accident. You may remember from last year's State of the City that I spoke about the importance of codifying all of our various economic development incentives and aggressive approaches to be able to present companies with a universe of confidence and knowledge that other communities simply cannot provide. That work set the stage for us to offer the most aggressive industrial review guarantee for planning and building reviews in Oregon, by adopting in code that they will be conducted within a 66-day period. For companies like Subaru, time and money are synonymous. So when it came down to selecting where to locate, we rose to the top of the stack. And in addition to the 66-day review, we implemented a second round of the Garage to Storefront program, this time focused on additional building improvements, and we spearheaded the early stages of our Centers and Corridors project, which you will continue to hear about in years to come, as it helps us attract redevelopment, commercial investment, and additional retail amenities in key areas of Gresham. Our growth rate in business investment is cause for great optimism. In 2014, we had a healthy $71 million in new business projects added to Gresham. In the past year, 2015, we saw that number more than double to $155 million in business project valuation. That gives you some idea of the magnitude of the year that we had. Now, we have certainly been fortunate to see some improvement in the regional economy, but that improvement does not alone explain the progress we're making. The City Council's business acumen, their unified approach, and their aggressiveness has positioned us well, and under the leadership of Eric Kvarsten, one of the best city managers in the entire country, our dedicated city staff continues to force the bounds of creativity and deliver exceptional results. I want to tell you a little something about our city manager, and he shies away from being talked about. He doesn't like to boast and all that, which I all appreciate, but I get to boast about him. Eric Kvarsten, I've had the privilege of working with him for the last decade or so. I have to tell you, he is absolutely one of the finest individuals, both professionally and personally, I have ever come across. He works for this city in an unbelievable way, and I have to tell you, he may not know I know this, but I know it. He's recruited almost monthly. City of Salem made a huge run at this man, offered him a whole heck of a lot more money than we could give him, and he's staying right here to deliver for this community, and we are very fortunate that he is. Eric, thank you for your leadership and your work. So that creativity and that persistence should pay off handsomely this year, as progress on the Catalyst site, now referred to as Rockwood Rising, reaches a new high. We now have a developer on board who has been extremely successful in similar projects across the region, and we're starting the design for this spring of several new buildings on the site. Not only will the physical development that occurs on the site help boost the urban form in the neighborhood, but the actual functions that will occur on the site will, at the direction of the Redevelopment Commission, be focused directly on innovation, technology, jobs and employment, and small format commerce and food and community. Now, while there are a number of bright spots on the economic development and growth front, we continue to focus on some long-needed growth areas in Gresham, such as opportunities for our youth, homelessness prevention and law enforcement, and neighborhood livability. In last year's speech, you heard me say that my top growth priority for Gresham rests with our children and our families. And I'm very excited to discuss our growth in this arena today. To set up the discussion, please turn your attention to the screen for a short video about our progress.
One of the ways we go beyond at the City of Gresham is by finding creative ways to provide new opportunities for kids and families. Our free Summer Kids in the Parks program, launched in 2014 in partnership with Boys and Girls Clubs, has been incredibly popular with parents and children alike, providing physical games, a healthy sack lunch, and fun in some of our highest use parks.
We hear from lots of families that just love the program, who have lived in Gresham for a long time and for many years haven't enjoyed those kinds of amenities in their city. So it's really great to be able to start providing those amenities again for all of our families.
The city also sponsors Rock the Block, a two-day block party in Rockwood connecting more than 2,000 youth and families to positive activities and resources, and leveraged a state grant for gang prevention as well as community partnerships to create a free Friday night basketball program for local youth. With state grant funding, we launched an innovative youth jobs program in partnership with Southeast Works, connecting at-risk youth with job skills and paid work experiences in the community. And thanks to assistance from Multnomah County, our Summer Works program employs 6 local youth to help with graffiti removal, park maintenance, and other important tasks. One of these youths was even instrumental in bringing a new amenity to Rockwood's Vance Park, With funding from the Portland Timbers, a pair of new outdoor futsal courts replaced an unused hockey court in September, providing youth in Rockwood with a new place to stay active.
Yeah, we see approximately over 500 people on average going out a week and playing rain or shine, night or day. And I'm one of them. What the city is wanting to do is invest in the youth and letting them know there's opportunities out there.
Recently, with support from the city, Friends of the Children celebrated the opening of its new campus, while Open School East broke ground on its new facility, and Boys and Girls Clubs gets ready to break ground on a new clubhouse scheduled to open later this year. Last year, the city established the city's Commission on Children and Families, a group of volunteers that will craft recommendations for City Council on how to better serve youth and families. And we continue to work closely with local teams, including those serving on our Youth Advisory Committee and at the Center for Advanced Learning. Our YAC members spearheaded the world record-breaking Chalk of Fame and have taken on other special projects to combat graffiti, give back to the community, and reach out to younger residents on social media. Students at Cal have worked with the city to produce creative videos and are now building a website to help with our urban renewal efforts.
When you see kids out playing in your parks, engaging with positive adult role models, when you see young people grinning from ear to ear because they just got their first paycheck, then you know we're on the right track.
Focusing on the health, happiness, and potential of children and families is a great investment in Gresham's present and its future. Together, we're going beyond to make sure all of our residents have access to fun, enriching activities, and opportunities to thrive.
So as you saw in the video, the past 2 years in Gresham have been ground shifting in youth engagement. We have now wrapped up our second year of Summer Kids in the Park program and had very promising results with that. Our SKIP program is a partnership with Boys and Girls Club, which has been a tremendous addition to service provisions in Gresham, and it will only grow in its positive influence as they near the construction of their service center in Rockwood. In 2014, we had a daily average of 91 kids participating in SKIP programming at three parks in Gresham, which was a solid number considering that it was more or less the only recreational programming we had done in Gresham in around 15 years. In 2015, that number increased by nearly 50% to 135 daily participants. The video also showed our very successful Friday night basketball program for at-risk youth. This program remains near and dear to my heart, and I'm abundantly excited to announce today that we will be expanding that program in 2016 to include an additional night, Saturdays, at the beautiful new location of Friends of the Children adjacent to Pat Pfeiffer Park. Yeah. Friends just celebrated their grand opening of this amazing new asset, and very few things excite me as much about our hope for reaching our most vulnerable children as much as this organization does. The proof is in their data. 83% of the youth in their program graduate on time, although 60% have a parent who did not graduate high school. 93% avoid the juvenile justice system, although 50% have parents who were incarcerated. And 98% have avoided early parenting, despite the fact that 85% were born to teen mothers. They are the best in the business. And in addition to our growth in SKIP and late night basketball, we have also been hard at work in expanding the physical amenities for youth as well. Under the leadership of one of Gresham's youngest leaders, Ricky Ruiz, we were able to turn the former roller hockey rink at Vance Park, a blighted eyesore, into two beautiful new futsal courts. Now, if you haven't heard Ricky's story yet, you're in for a treat. This young man grew up in Rockwood, and he can tell you stories of jumping the fence at the old roller rink with his friends to play futsal on the dilapidated asphalt, often using backpacks and school books to form goals. Now, if you've met Ricky, you'll know that two things become immediately clear to you. He is contagiously optimistic, and he's a solid young leader. He put together a plan to make these futsal courts a reality, and he delivered on that plan by enlisting the help of the Portland Timbers, Operation Pitch Invasion, and the U.S. Soccer Foundation. The courts were built at almost no cost to the city of Gresham. As the video mentioned, Ricky has been a member of our team for the past year. Thanks in large part to the assistance of the Summer Works Grant through the Work Systems, Inc. He stands as an example of what is possible when you're able to connect talented local kids here in Gresham with the types of opportunities that they need to change the world. Ricky, please stand so your community can give you a proper thank you. You know, Ricky could have sat in front of a computer screen. He could have complained on the blogosphere or nextdoor.com or whatever that Gresham doesn't have enough futsal courts. He could have had a bad attitude. He could have joined the visceral blogosphere of experts who can point out all the problems, but they seem to evaporate when it comes to putting work into a solution. Instead, he did the opposite. And we're all better off for that. So at the age of 21, Ricky has already made a huge contribution. And I want to tell you, he sits just down the hall from me at City Hall. I've never once heard him complain, not once. Good job, Ricky. Well, not specifically a youth program, I don't want to miss the opportunity to mention the blast we had as a community getting together at the art festival this summer to crush the Guinness World Record. Now, this effort was spearheaded in part by Gresham's Youth Advisory Committee, which has been an excellent resource for the city. We appreciate their contributions and definitely their perspectives, and we appreciate all of the people who came out that day to help us make our way into the record book. Raise your hand if you participated in the Chalk of Fame. There we go. Yeah, it was incredible watching Gresham's longstanding families and our new residents alike join together on a blistering hot day in July to be a community and to be a part of something positive. Gresham's long relationship with the arts through music festivals and community events like the Art Festival remain vital and healthy. And under the leadership of Judy Hahn, the newly formed Gresham Outdoor Public Arts Group is doing tremendous work to bring new public art to our city. Judy and your team, thank you for doing what you do. And I'm certainly excited about the opportunities being created for youth and families across Gresham, but I am particularly proud of the reality that this slide displays. If you start to watch some of the critical mass of progress we have been making in the greater Rockwood area through the location of the Boys and Girls Club, the Friends of the Children, NADACA, Open School, Late Night Basketball, Futsal in Vance Park, and the Rockwood Rising Project, you can see the hope that we have for years to come. We must grab that hope and we must keep our pedal on the momentum. We simply cannot allow gangs to be an alternate family structure for our young residents. Thank you. There is no doubt that a strong connection exists between engaging our youth with recreation and opportunities and changing some of our more worrisome outcomes. It is exactly the challenge that sparked our creation of Gresham's Commission on Children and Families last year. The Commission's charge is simultaneously simple, yet incredibly challenging. Discover ways to make Gresham a better place for our youngest residents and their families. Well, the members have been appointed and they're hard at work researching opportunities. The Commission is using national best practices and they're diving into data on our schools, our recreational programs, and neighborhood safety. Though the committee is about halfway through their inaugural year, and they're still analyzing the numbers to inform their eventual recommendations to council, the committee is delving deep into the effect of attendance as an indicator of educational success, as well as geographical distribution and effectiveness of existing after-school recreation programs. And on the subject of safety, a key component of any family-friendly community, the Commission is interested in increasing neighborhood connectedness, including the Neighborhood Ready program, which pairs Neighborhood Watch with emergency preparedness. And I'm anxious to hear more about their work, and we greatly appreciate their heart for Gresham's kids. Their work will build on the progress made by the Rise Advance Dream, or RAD, campaign from past years. That effort helped establish some priorities regarding amenities, services, and additions to help make Gresham prosper. We now have a universe of ideas on the table and a great group of people poised to find strategic ways to pursue them. One bright amenity that will soon be added to Gresham's portfolio is the Hogan Butte Nature Park. This is another one I've been speaking about for years because it really will, upon completion, immediately become one of the nicest parks in the entire region. With a staggering view of the Gresham skyline, Mount Rainier, Mount Jefferson, Mount Hood, Mount St. Helens, Mount Adams, and the Columbia River Gorge. Hogan Butte was at one time the Trust for Public Land's top priority for public acquisition, and I'm thrilled to report that at long last, the project is on pace, and we're scheduled to complete construction by December of this year, with an anticipated community celebration and grand opening to follow. We have a lot to celebrate, but we also have some significant work ahead of us. We have some tough decisions to make. To be perfectly clear, while I'm incredibly proud of the youth and family programs and amenities that we have developed in the past couple years, I'm not satisfied boasting about services we have cobbled together with baling wire and duct tape. While it is tempting in these types of speeches to speak to the virtues of our hard work on an issue, while glossing over or ignoring the challenges that are still ahead of us, I think you know by now that I'm not a person who's really interested in sugarcoating anything. So I'm going to strive for some balance here. If we are going to retain our strong families in Gresham, we're going to have to face the harsh reality that we are in competition with every other suburban community in the Portland region. Now, don't get me wrong, we have a ton going for us. If you want to live in a community with an authentic downtown, complete with a local merchant economy, well, Gresham's your place. If you value historic roots, authentic neighborhoods, and classic character, you can't beat us. If you want an affordable house and a livable neighborhood, we're still in first place. And trust me, that's not just rhetoric. 3 years ago, during this speech, I spoke about young families moving to Gresham in pursuit of affordable opportunity. At the time, I think some folks thought I was crazy. But that was 2013, I had a hunch, and now we have some data. In 2015, we had more residential real estate transactions than we have seen in over a decade, topping even 2006 numbers. So while we have a lot of momentum on our side, I don't want the Commission on Children and Families or anybody else in this room to ignore our pressing needs. If you want things like a community center, we don't have an answer for you in Gresham, despite most of our peers boasting multiple assets in this category. If you want full-service recreation services with solid programming, we're still behind the mark. Most alarmingly, if you, like every single parent in the United States of America, want your kids to get a solid education, the trend lines aren't necessarily in our favor. This slide shows an unfortunate reality, but one that we need to collectively own. There are seemingly a million different ways to slice and dice education data, which makes it difficult at times to tell a comprehensive story. One quick way to look at the progress of our schools is to consider the percentage of on-time graduates emerging from our districts and compare that to our peers. And as you can see here, we have some work to do. But here's the thing about schools. In addition to being critically important to the futures of our youth, they are also livability drivers in Gresham's efforts to attract families to our cities and to keep the families that we currently have. If you're cruising Zillow and you find out that the elementary school in your neighborhood you're considering is a 1 on a scale of 1 to 10, you are without a doubt going to keep looking. This of course, exasperates that issue. We can get stuck in a self-fulfilling and self-defeating cycle. We all need to rise together, but our elected school boards have a responsibility to own their piece of the solution as well. You know, Oregon is famous for having delegations from across the country and across the world come to our state to witness our innovative approach to public policy, be it our protection of beaches, our natural areas, our leadership on clean energy, our innovations in public transportation. Heck, I've even had a dozen or so international delegates come to visit our sewage treatment plant. It's true. But to my knowledge, not a single delegation has come to Oregon to learn about our approach to public education. Don't you think that's a problem? Oregon has abysmal educational outcomes, and there's no other side of the coin on this. There's no excuse for failure on this at all. And while we clearly have some room for improvement, I know that our elected school leaders are as concerned as we are about changing our outcomes and improving the quality of all schools. And to be clear, we are all going to have to own our piece of that solution as well. Ultimately, that's what being a community is all about. We collectively own so much infrastructure and services, from water and sewer pipes to roads and bridges. And that collective ownership can be frustrating at times when our individual visions don't align. But it is also refreshing in that it is the only action on scale that can appropriately address important needs. It's no secret to anybody in Gresham who has driven much on our residential streets that we have significant deferred maintenance issues. We have squeezed the last few years to do more residential maintenance than at any point in the recent past. But it's a drop in the bucket compared to the need. So my pledge on the city side is that the council will push incredibly hard on the organization to free up existing resources for residential street maintenance, no matter what. While nothing will change our aggressiveness in freeing up resources, I want to be perfectly clear that our counterparts at the state of Oregon have consistently been letting us down by not taking action to shore up funding deficiencies in the revenue streams that traditionally fund street maintenance. And at some point, in the continuing absence of state and federal leadership, we will collectively have to find a path that works for us here locally to address the deficiencies and solve the problems going forward. And that won't be easy. As you likely know by now, it concerns me that our voters haven't approved revenue in Gresham since the early 1990s. And as a lifelong fiscally conservative Republican, I feel qualified to say that that isn't a Tea Party or Donald Trump badge of courage. What it means is that we lose while others win. Ironically, that type of defeatist attitude is the same kind of moral bankruptcy that thinks it is compassionate to leave mentally ill and substance addicted people camping out in our open spaces, our parks, our sidewalks, and our neighborhoods. I'll be perfectly clear. Homelessness is a bigger issue in the greater Portland area than it has been since the pioneers of the Oregon Trail moved from their Conestoga wagons into wooden structures. And that's not hyperbole. Unfortunately, it is reality. And it is unconscionable to me that we let our homeless subsist in shanty towns. That is not the Gresham ethic. For years, Gresham has greeted this issue with compassion and solutions in an environment that is short on both. This is the city where my father's house built a family shelter without a single dime of public money. This is a community that has consistently supported Human Solutions in their effort to rehabilitate people to employment and self-sufficiency. Unfortunately, there are those who would sit back and believe that for some people, camping out on our trails and our open spaces is the best that they can do. For context, let me show you what some of these solutions look like. Now, I feel like I shouldn't have to say that there's obviously nothing humane or acceptable about those images. I have deeply admired Multnomah County Chair Deborah Cafori's interest in and leadership on the issue. She has put the county's money where her mouth is, and she has pledged a substantial increase in the funding available to tackle homelessness. She's also set aside a modest appropriation for Gresham, which we will use to provide a balance of social work, vocational rehabilitation, cleanup, and law enforcement services starting next month. Chair Cafori, Commissioner McKeel, once again, thank you for your partnership. This new program will add to our existing relationship with JOIN, which we have increased in recent years to move people out of homelessness. And if you aren't familiar with their work, JOIN is an organization that takes some of the toughest cases and resolves them through a housing first model. With this combination of efforts, I'm confident that we will continue to make progress in getting people housed. Now, that said, we also absolutely will not sit by idly and watch the fallout of this issue destroy our natural resources and threaten our neighborhood livability. Starting this week, we have implemented a natural resource exclusion along the Springwater Trail, just to the north of Gresham's southwest neighborhood. For too long, we've watched habitat investments in the millions be threatened by a small group of self-proclaimed homeless constitutionalists, whatever that means. Well, That stops now. We will be restricting a 60-acre area to any and all human activity, homeless or not, until such time as the environment can rebound. And hopefully, this course of action will provide some relief for the environment, the neighborhood, and provide an opportunity to get some of our most society-resistant individuals into stable housing and opportunity. Homelessness is an overwhelmingly broad societal issue impacting communities across the nation, especially up and down the West Coast. And as a nation, we have a lot of work to do to change the economic, substance abuse, and mental health circumstances that too often lead to homelessness. And we also need to take a close look at some of the legal restrictions that too often tie the hands of local governments to maintain health, safety, and order in their communities. Once again, I don't want to sound uncompassionate on this issue, because I'm not. I spent part of my childhood in a mobile home, and many people had it worse than me. But I want to be clear, my roots are modest. But at the same time, I am beyond frustrated by the absurd notion that pitching tents under freeway overpasses or occupying our parks and trails is some sort of solution whatsoever. Those who believe so need to do some deep soul searching and reconnect with the sensible people that they represent. Our approach to homelessness in Gresham is and will continue to be compassionate, but it will not be delusional. Our neighborhood enforcement team, very popular already amongst our residents, will get an extra boost and become the Neighborhood Enhancement Action Team, or NEAT, if you will. And if you think that acronym is a little bit too cute, you're right, and you have our retiring police chief, Craig Juniger, to thank for that. And I'm not quite done with Craig yet. I'll get back to him in a minute. The NEAT team is a combination of law enforcement, rental housing inspection, code enforcement, and social work that will help us tackle all sorts of livability issues, and it'll maintain the line when it comes to protecting our neighborhoods and our shared spaces. And here's a short video about the details of their impactful work in the city.
Going beyond means actually caring about the community that you work in. A lot of police problems arise. You handle that call and you move on to the next call. On the NET team, we go beyond that. We find out what the problem is. We talk to the residents. We talk to the people that it involves. And we find out exactly what the root cause is, and then we try to address that problem. We work with code enforcement, rental housing, the building department, the fire department, and it brings all of us together to come at a problem from different approaches, different angles. Everywhere we go, people wave at us and they say, oh, hey, you're those NET guys. And I think they see that we follow through, we do what we say we're going to do.
Looking for a long-term fix rather than just slap a band-aid on it. Because if we can prevent crime from occurring, then we've done a service to the community. When they know they can approach just about anyone in the city and voice a problem, and that employee or that representative of the city makes eye contact with them, shows them that we care, and tells them we are going to address this, it just helps build that sense of community and trust with the city.
Yeah, those guys. This is just the latest innovation in a department that has been a constant source of creativity and ingenuity despite limited resources. Though we have fewer officers per capita than nearly every single city in Oregon, we have tremendous law enforcement services and a department full of men and women who bring professionalism to everything that they do. Okay, back to Craig for just a moment. So, Chief Juniger's many things to me. He's one of the finest police chiefs I've ever encountered. He's an admirable and experienced public servant. He's creative and strategic. He's a strong leader with a thick skin, well, mostly thick skin. He has a great sense of humor. And since he came here 7 years ago, I'm proud to say he's a friend. I'm not a super sentimental guy, you know, but I will miss Craig. I'm not sure he'll miss the grief I've caused him, though. But please give Chief Juniger a round of applause. Thank him for his exceptional service to our city. And while we're on the topic of public safety, I want to recognize that as a country, we've had some discourse lately about police brutality and about abuses of power. And I understand that this is an issue in some places in the country, even in some places not too far from us. I had the pleasure of serving on the U.S. Conference of Mayors Working Group of Mayors and Police Chiefs, which provided local government input for the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing. This is a complex issue with many issues and challenges. But I want to be clear that in Gresham, we have tremendously professional police officers who impress me both in the incredible restraint they show in their work and in their dogged ability to capture their suspects. I gotta tell you, if you're hoping to continue your criminal enterprise, I can tell you emphatically, Gresham is absolutely a horrible place to commit a crime. We will catch you, I promise you. It is also worth mentioning, in light of last week's brutal killing of a Seaside police officer and the 10 police officers nationwide who we have already lost this year, that this is not an easy job, and that the men and women who wear the badge and uniform are taking the ultimate risk each and every day that they work. I cannot imagine the grief currently being experienced by the family and friends of Officer Jason Gooding, but by all accounts, he was simply one of the best that there was. We stand with the citizens of Seaside today as we mourn with them, and please join me in taking a moment of silence to recognize the sacrifice made by Officer Jason Gooding. Thank you. I can tell you firsthand that Gresham police officers are some of the most tremendous individuals you will ever encounter. Let me tell you about a couple of them. Gresham has a very long and successful relationship with the Federal Community Oriented Policing Services, or COPS, program. It's operated through the Department of Justice. We've lobbied for these federal funds for years, and they've resulted in about 13 full-time officers being funded in the past half dozen years. Two of those positions funded through the program have been dedicated to school resource officers. And I want to introduce you today to Officers Sweezy and Rasmussen. School resource officers are nothing new to Gresham, but having the added capacity to focus these officers specifically on truancy issues has been a real ground shifter. In a relatively short period of time, these two officers have opened up 90 cases dealing with truant children, around 60 of which have multiple at-risk children in the home. While Sweezy and Rasmussen have been out there trying to keep our children in school and help them be successful, they have not forgotten that they are also law enforcement officers focused on helping the most vulnerable among us. In two separate situations so far, truancy investigations have brought suspicion that some of our most vulnerable children are being impacted by human trafficking situations. In the first case, the juvenile the officers were concerned about wasn't even initially their primary focus, but it was a friend of a student with attendance issues. The officers put the pieces together and realized she was falling victim to trafficking and put out an order of protection for the young lady, which resulted in her being rescued during the next encounter with law enforcement. She's now receiving treatment, she's living clean and sober, and she's leading a productive life. You ever wonder if cops make a difference? They do. In the second case, a 16-year-old female wrote in her diary about being forced into sex trafficking, which was discovered by her mother. Unfortunately, the youth was initially unwilling to cooperate with detectives, which would have too often been the end of the story for us. In this case, however, the outcome was different. While the youth was not willing to work with detectives, she did work with our school resource officers who helped her enter into a GED program specifically for at-risk youth. And as part of this program and through intensive counseling, she eventually disclosed the details of her circumstances, and her perpetrator was arrested and prosecuted. Officers Sweezy and Rasmussen are here with us today. Gentlemen, please stand and be recognized for your tremendous contribution. So just today in my email was another story that we didn't have in the speech, but I wanted to share it with you because I think it speaks to the heart of our police department and the heart of this organization. So this came in my email today. It says, Officer Martin Daly responded to a shoplifting call, and after viewing the video at the store and some investigation, he was able to locate the suspect in an apartment in nearby Portland. Now, the items that were taken were baby formula, DVDs, and toothbrushes. And when he entered the apartment, he found the suspect, her husband, and four children, ages 9, 5, 1, and 2 months. The female suspect admitted to the theft and indicated that it was her son's birthday. Officer Daly arrested the female, he cited and released her at the scene, and he responded back to Safeway to return the items. After returning the items, Officer Daly, two MGID officers, Officer Costigan and Deputy McQueen, purchased the items along with a $50 gift card. They returned to the suspect, yeah. They returned to the suspect's apartment and gave her the items for her children. And Safeway also stepped up and donated some cupcakes for the birthday. So you want to know why I've only had a handful of legitimately bad days in this job? I'll tell you. It's because of the people I just mentioned and the thousands of times every year Gresham employees go above and beyond to make the lives of our citizens better. There are many examples of our employees personally investing in the everyday lives of Gresham residents. But I want to tell you about one recent example that impacted nearly everyone in Gresham who drives a car. What do you do when 6 inches of rainfall in a 72-hour period causes debris flows so substantial that they block a 112-inch culvert and wash out a major arterial roadway above it, instantly taking down the preferred route for 35,000 vehicle trips a day? Well, if you are the city of Gresham, the answer is work for a month straight, nights and weekends, through Christmas, New Year's, a snowstorm, and you spare no effort until the road is back open. Here's a short video describing the effort it took to reopen that.
On December 7th, a historic rainfall event occurred throughout the Pacific Northwest. Here in Gresham, our area streams rose very quickly. We had localized flooding around the city, as most cities did. Here at Kelly Creek, which I'm standing next to, we had a large log that floated down the creek and plugged the culvert under Kane Drive. The water rose very quickly and the pressure became so great that it blew the entire roadway out. Now this was a magnitude of storm event that only happens once every 50 to 100 years. So most people in the community had never seen anything quite so severe. City staff mobilized very quickly. Our engineering teams, our communications staff, mayor and city council, everybody got together. We did what we needed to do to react to this disaster in a way that was going to get Kane Drive up and running and minimize the impact on our citizens. We were making decisions in minutes as opposed to days or weeks. We got a contractor on board, More Excavation, a local contractor, gave them the notice to proceed on December 23rd, and by January 15th, they had this project done. A tremendous amount of physical movement of rock and excavation and just people working around the clock. After this occurred, I remember distinctly meeting with the mayor and city manager to explain the magnitude of what we were facing. In the mayor's own special way, I think he let us know that we could do better. And he challenged us to do better. And I'm particularly proud of this effort because all hands were on deck. City staff, contractors, mayor and city council, Everybody was behind this project because it had such an impact on the community. And I have not seen an effort of this magnitude go this smoothly, this quickly, this efficiently in my professional career.
As you saw in the video, this was no small undertaking. The repair required that 10,390 cubic yards of material be moved and that 320 feet of corrugated metal culvert be installed. And it's hard to explain in words the scale of this infrastructure project, but it is a testament to fortitude that the road was reopened so quickly, and equally impressive that our city staff documented everything amazingly well throughout the project, beginning to end, in order to ensure that we are well situated to receive federal reimbursement. Kane is not done yet, unfortunately. We will need to go back there to construct a permanent solution at some point in the coming years. But at least we will be able to pick the time frame instead of it picking us, and we should be able to keep at least two lanes open throughout the vast majority of the project. And while I'm on the topic of Kane Road, let me point out one more group of people who impressed me tremendously during that nightmare. You, Gresham residents, you showed a level of interest, patience, understanding, and civility in discourse that, well, quite frankly, was refreshing in an environment where it seems like bombastic, mean-spirited, irrational rhetoric has taken over our national discourse. Gresham residents never cease to amaze me by demonstrating exactly what it means to belong in a society and cooperate with each other. But don't worry, they also aren't bashful to let me know exactly what is on their minds at any given moment. Try local first. A few of you can relate. Mark Garber. Kane Road is just but one example of the type of ingenuity, innovation, and expediency of our work in all service areas, and that what it will require us in the years to come. We know we cannot do business the way it has always been done. Just as you know that businesses in your arena don't, if they don't change and innovate, they're not long for the world. When it comes to examples of the opportunities we have in this arena, there's some particularly exciting work being done in our Fire and Emergency Services Department. We now have a pilot project in the works to deploy a quick response vehicle, or a QRV, to respond to a host of non-life-threatening medical calls, which would have previously required the full deployment of a fire engine and a crew. If the QRV can take some of the peak hour pressure off of our medical calls, we can realize two critical outcomes. One, cost savings for our taxpayers, and two, better service for our residents. I want to pause for a moment and recognize that Chief Greg Matthews, one of Gresham's very own, was a key leader in getting this long-desired service up and running. Chief Matthews has worked at every level of the Gresham Fire Department, which made him a tremendous asset in designing this pilot program and deploying it effectively. Thank you, Chief Matthews. Along with Greg, we had some exceptional help from our city management, and notably from our firefighter and EMS employees represented through their union. Change can be scary, no doubt. And these men and women were willing to work with us to get to the right solution. In addition to the QRV, we have a very exciting partnership with OHSU nursing students through the Gresham Cares program. These students reach out to citizens following contact with Gresham Fire and Emergency Services, and they determine if additional services from local area programs are needed. When these students are successful in this work, it results in both healthier residents and fewer calls for expensive emergency services. These are just two examples of the types of reform measures our enterprise will need to pursue vigorously in the years to come. We will change, we'll innovate, we'll adjust, and we'll evaluate as we go, but we will not stop in our pursuit of optimal services optimally delivered. You know, I got a little grief for delivering my speech in conjunction with the Chamber of Commerce today. Well, I shouldn't say I got grief. I didn't get grief. I got another opportunity to give it tonight at 6 o'clock at City Hall. You know, I think there's an unfortunate misconception that this is a room full of multimillionaires, which I'm sure will come to a surprise as many of you. But my experience has always been that the chamber is full of hardworking men and women who are desperately trying to start and grow their enterprises with modest means and little else besides each other to rely on. My experience is also that this has always been a group of folks willing to step up, just like our other community leaders, our faith leaders, nonprofit leaders, and neighborhood leaders, to serve our city, volunteer time and donate funds, and absolutely unabashedly promote our community whenever possible and extol the virtues of what we have going here. And we have plenty going for us. What Gresham has lacked in public resources and stable funding, it has always more than made up for in character, camaraderie, a sense of place and purpose, a willingness to help one another. And more than anything, I'm betting on that right now. Those community themes and that ethic of stewardship and service reverberates throughout the city of Gresham and throughout the city workforce. As I begin to wrap this up, I want to tell you one last story. 4 days before Christmas, this past December, off-duty Gresham detective Dan Marciano was with his wife at a shopping center in Clackamas. They noticed some commotion while walking through the parking lot, so Dan went over to check things out. That's what detectives do, you know, they go check things out. As he arrived at the incident, Detective Marciano encountered a 67-year-old man in full cardiac arrest. And without a second thought, Dan dropped to the ground and began CPR. And what you're about to watch on the screen behind you, or behind me, is the video from Dan's wife's phone. Detective Marciano was able to continue CPR until paramedics arrived and transported the patient to the hospital. The male subject survived thanks to the life-saving efforts of Detective Dan Marciano. He lived to have another Christmas, more hugs with his family, and the continuation of life itself. Dan is here with us today. Yeah, give him a hand. Dan, stand up. I want to recognize him for what he did. Yeah. Boys, which one of those voices was yours? Oh, I knew it. If you could see those two kids' faces and eyes looking up at you, Dan, and what a hero you are to them. You're a hero to us too, so thank you for all that you did. That's what this whole thing is all about, helping each other when we need it the most. In a single word, it is my estimation that the state of the city is poised. We are self-reflective enough to honestly assess our gaps and needs, yet we're self-reliant enough to put the work in to continue to invest with optimism. We gladly answer our call to honor the responsibility of inheriting this great place and happily serve our shift as the stewards of this incredible community. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today and for all that you all do in our community. It is an honor of a lifetime to serve as your mayor, but I couldn't do it, I would never do it, without people like you stepping up alongside us and serving one another. That collective willingness to serve and sacrifice, in a nutshell, is the state of our city.
Whoa. Ooh, did you see the kissy hug stuff? He scored. There we go. Was a good speech and a great reward. There comes a time when one must take a position that is neither safe, nor political, nor popular, but must take it because conscience tells him it is right. Martin Luther King Jr., in the Testament of Hope, the Essential Writings, wrote that. Now, we know the context and the reasons that Mr. King wrote that. But doesn't it apply to so many other situations as well? Neither safe, nor political, nor popular, but you take a position because your conscience tells you that it's right? Thank you, Mayor. On behalf of the residents and the business owners, not just in this room, but in the entire community, in fact, in the entire region, for your service to all of Gresham, for being willing to take positions that are not safe or political or popular, but because you know in your heart that they're the right thing to do for our community. Okay, I could get in really big trouble because you forgot him if I don't introduce my boss and the president of the Gresham Chamber. Warner, would you please stand? Thank you. Thank you. Actually, I forgot him, but I like to pass off blame. On behalf of the president of the chamber and of the entire chamber membership and all of City Hall, I want to thank every single one of you for coming out today, spending the time to hear the State of the City address. Thank you, and have a safe afternoon.